Good morning and welcome to the Justice Committee 20th meeting of 2014. Can I ask everyone to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices as they interfere with broadcasting, even when they're switched to silent? Apologies have been received from Margaret Mitchell, item 1. The committee is invited to agree to consider a report in the SSI we considered in previous weeks relating to drink private limit under item 4 in private. Are you agreed? Thank you very much. Item 2, draft budget scrutiny. This is our first item of business and evidence session on the Scottish Government's draft budget 2015-16, our second day of scrutiny. The police budget will hear from two panels of witnesses. And I welcome to the meeting Calum Steele. Calum, you are a panel. There you are. General Secretary of the Scottish Police Federation. Members will recall that we arranged this extra session as the SPF was unable to attend last week. We have your written submission, for which I thank you. And I'll go straight to questions from members. Questions, please. John and Christian and then Elaine, please.
Morning, Callum. As you're probably aware, that there has been some concern raised about whether we have a balanced workforce or not. And so probably a kind of yes or no first question. Did you consider that the police workforce was balanced before unification?
Balanced and workforce are two words that make individual sense in the English language, but I'm not sure that when it comes to the police service, they're words that attract much consideration other than the fact that they're readily banded around. I don't know what is meant by a balanced workforce. I assume, to some extent, it means that when there is the correct mix of support staff and police officers. Now, short of getting into ratios, which I know that chief constables have historically been reluctant to do, there's always going to be a job somewhere that could be done by someone else, be it a member of police staff or a police officer, or indeed would be better suited to it. Ultimately, given the statutory responsibility of the chief constable to deliver an effective and efficient police service, he is the only person that could ultimately answer whether he considers the workforce to be balanced. But there is clearly a considerable concern about the loss of support staff that's taken place over the past couple of years in particular. And I certainly don't intend to rehash many of my contributions to this committee last year. But I consider that the mix is probably about right. There is going to be a considerable period of flux when there are square pegs in round holes and round pegs in square holes. Now, that's not ideal, but I think it is an inevitable consequence of taking what was 8 and plus 1, 9 services and jamming them together to make one.
If you then consider, Callum, that the mix is perhaps right, but why in your submission did you then put forward a suggestion that perhaps local authorities should take up the role of spending money on support staff for the police rather than police officers?
I'm glad you asked the question in that way, Mr. Pentland, because I noticed when the question was put to Mr. Diamond previously of Unison, the inference was that I suggested, or that the Scottish Police Federation suggested, that local authorities should go back to employing support staff, and that absolutely isn't the case. The reason I highlighted it in these terms is that much of the concern, and I think we'll probably get onto it, I suspect, without wishing to second-guess Ms. Murray's contribution later on, maybe some of the issues around about the control room syndrome fees might be a feature for today. But it seems to me that there are more creative solutions out there than those that are currently being deployed. Clearly, the local authorities, when they directly fund, and indeed to some extent they still do directly fund police officers, they don't themselves act as the employer for the police officer. In much the same way that I don't think they would act as the employer for the member of support staff. But I do believe it would provide opportunities for local authorities and local communities to come up with more imaginative solutions to keeping employment in the area and supporting the police service. Because one thing that I think everybody has agreed on is that the police service is more than just about police officers. So if it's about the delivery of the police service, why not look at it beyond just the simple man or woman in the woolly suit?
Are you then aware, Callum, of any police officers doing backroom work? And I think probably, I just can't remember offhand the name of the lady who was given evidence last week, but she said that you're not doing work, you know, you're covering type thing. So, you know, is there I mean, do you know of any instances where police officers are actually doing backroom work?
I think you would one of the things, again, Mr. Pentland, that we always struggle with in the police service is getting a clear definition of what is meant by backroom and what is meant by front line. But I'm certainly aware that there are instances where there are police officers that are doing sometimes jobs that were in the past done by support staff. Like I said, I think that's an example of sometimes we've got square pegs and round holes and round pegs and square holes, but it's an inevitable consequence of transition. A large part of that, I suspect some of the examples will be cited, will apply to control rooms, contact centres, whatever name they happen to apply, and also to custody areas. I seem to recall that the Chief Constable gave an assurance last year that there is no long-term policy of introducing backfilling support staff roles with police officers, and I've got no reason to disbelieve that that's anything other than its intention.
You may think, Mr. Steele, that it's inevitable because of transition, you know, about putting square pegs into round holes, but I'm asking you, do you think it's right?
Yes, I'm afraid I do. And the reason is that police officers are a more flexible resource. There are times when the skills of police officers allow them to do a job for a short period of time. These are not continual, ongoing backfilling commitments. If it was to be in those circumstances, then of course I would consider that would be not acceptable. But in some instances, I'm not saying in all, the issue of the cost of the delivery of service I don't think is properly appreciated. There are many support staff roles performed by retired police officers. Now, the salary of that member of support staff may well be lower than the police officer themselves, but when you consider that there may well be an ill health pension on the back of that, or indeed a substantive pension on the back of that, that significantly alters the cost to the overall justice budget in delivering that service. And also, in removing large numbers of roles which were traditionally available for officers that were recuperating, that in some ways, to my mind, actually works against having a good and efficient use of police officers.
So one final question. You did say, Calum, that you think that perhaps the balanced workforce is now right. If that then is the case, are you then saying that perhaps no more backroom staff should be allowed to go? And are you then saying if the balanced workforce is again correct, where would you anticipate further resources being found, savings being found?
Well, again, Mr. Pentland, it would be my desire that no member of staff loses their employment. I think it's a particularly difficult circumstances and events that unfolds when these kind of circumstances prevent themselves. But all of these decisions are consequence of financial decisions that are taken by this building here. The simple fact is that reductions to budgets over the years mean that there are going to be cuts. Now, it's easy enough to say where cuts shouldn't be made, but I think it's a lot harder for people to say where they should be. It's easy for me to sit here and say that I don't think anyone should lose their job, and it's easy for you to sit here and ask me whether I think it's right or fair that members of support staff have lost theirs and police officers undertake elements of backfilling on occasions. That's not going to get us to answer the question of what we do with the long-term financial challenges that are facing the service. And I do believe we collectively, service, politicians, local, Holyrood alike, need to be more honest about the real difficulty that we're looking at, not just this year, but for the next 15, 20 years.
This is a final question this time. Taking on board your comment there, what particular resource challenges do you see then that faces the Police Scotland for the future?
Yeah, thank you, Mr. Pentland. I mean, clearly, I've been around the police service now, despite my youthful appearance, for over 21 years, and actively involved in the Scottish Police Federation now for the guts of a decade, and indeed in my current role for over 6 years. And I've seen staffing costs, overall staffing costs, as a proportion of budget increasing quite considerably in that period of time. Now, there are two reasons for that. One is that there has been a healthy increase in police numbers, and the second is that there has been a decline in budget overall. It doesn't take someone with the brain of Einstein to work out that if staff costs keep going up, budget keeps going down, there will come a point of critical mass. And someone needs to stand up and tell us what it is that's going to happen. I think it's easy to say to the Chief Constable, what are you going to do? But until such time as our politicians tell our public that either they want fewer police officers, or they want more members of support staff, or they want fewer police officers but have, or more police officers but have them less well paid, then we're going to go around in circles year on year looking at these individual decisions, almost salami slicing elements to try and find solutions, where in reality that's not going to work.
John, I'm going to let you do one last question.
Are you then saying that the operational matters of Police Scotland should be in the hands of the politicians?
Absolutely not. But there are operational matters, and then there are wider issues such as how many police officers are considered appropriate for Scotland's streets. I don't think anyone could honestly say that the current government's policy of 1,000 extra police officers is an operational decision. It was a political decision, and one indeed which has been I think very welcome by our community, certainly very welcome by my colleagues, and indeed very welcome by a whole number of different people that you speak to. But there will come a point in time where politicians are going to have to say whether they think that the number of police officers is right, or whether they think it's wrong, or whether they think police officers get paid too much, or whether they think they don't get paid enough. And once those kind of honest discussions are going to be had, then we as a police service will be better placed to know what the expectation coming from this building is going to be for us.
I am going to move on, if that's okay now. John, you brought a supplementary. Is it about the role of local authorities?
No,
I want to ask that before you ask, because you didn't develop that, and I was interested in this point being made by you, Calum, that you dedicate funding to specialist support staff roles in their communities. What do you mean by that? Can you give an example of what you mean by that? What would they be doing?
Well, I suppose the detail would be something that would be thrashed out between local authorities and indeed the Chief Constable, or possibly even with a role for the authority. And possibly the horse may have gone in this particular example, but control rooms or the C3 project might have been a great opportunity, probably a missed opportunity now. No doubt that Ms Murray will consider that there was a highly skilled workforce available in Dumfries that lended itself really neatly to developing that kind of skill, not just for the police service, but also probably for utilising in wider elements of local government delivery. And that could have worked well in Dumfries. Another term, for example, may be if there is a particular abundance of highly trained accountants. I'm loath to use the term forensic accountants because I don't really know what that means, unless it's an accountant sitting with a white coat looking at a computer screen. But there may be opportunities for the very heavily skilled financial services indices in and around Edinburgh, or local authorities in and around Edinburgh, to offer support to the police service by saying, if you're looking for a future serious examination of financial crime, then why not look at using some skills that we could help with. Just two very
I just examples. Wanted to develop it because I think it's a sort of a fresh line in here. John, what was your supplementary?
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Mr Steele, it was about the issues that Mr Pentland raised about police officers undertaking support staff duties. And I appreciate my knowledge is time limited in this, but in my day, from memory, there were two categories of officer who in any case may have found themselves doing that. Those were people on protected duties, so new and expectant mothers, and restricted duties. This may well be police officers returning from a period, perhaps having been assaulted on duty, where they've not got the wherewithal to do full operational duties. Nothing changed on the 1st of April. These categories of officers presumably are still gainfully employed in Police Scotland as they would have been in the 9 constituent.
Yes, and whilst the terminology may change over time, but I mean the categories are broadly correct. The one that you would probably add to that now would be officers that are not protected or restricted, but are undertaking jobs where there have been reasonable adjustments because of disability. But yes, by and large, those category of officers still exist to some extent, undertaking these roles. I mean, there are some internal policy matters which I don't think it would be appropriate for thrashing around the committee when they're more suited for the internal mechanisms of the police service about the appropriateness or the approach that's being adopted for some of these deployments. But by and large, the categories that you gave are correct.
And the alternative to an individual officer being deployed in that way would be their requirement to retire on the grounds of ill health, presumably, which itself would have costs.
In many cases, that is indeed the case.
I'm expecting mothers quickly.
Well, hopefully not. but indeed, that is the case. If many officers are not able to be deployed or in those circumstances, then the question of an ill health retirement is certainly something that would be looked at. There is no guarantee, of course, that follows. And this is, this, like I said, we're probably getting into some of the internal policy stuff within the service just now, but we could have officers off on long periods of sick because of a refusal or an unwillingness to deploy them where pay still continues to be paid at that cost. So that's not an efficient use of the police time, but we risk drifting into policy.
Thank you.
I want to move on because I know we've got short time. Christian, followed by Elaine. Christian.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Mr. Steele. I find your honesty refreshing, and especially on your submission. And to go back to what you were saying early on regarding creative solutions to address the challenges we find in the budget. And we heard in the evidence last week, we heard a lot about redefining the role of police officers. What about these creative solutions? Will this creative solution we heard that could involve local authorities? Could it involve private sector? Could it involve maybe redefining the role of certain role of police officers we have today? I'm thinking particularly about the role that we have over the weekend for football matches, for example, or for over duties.
Thank you, Convener. I think there are opportunities for the service. In fact, not opportunities. There are expectations that the service, and indeed all services, look at every single avenue for how they are structured and deliver service to the public now and into the future. Private sector clearly has a role in some elements, as indeed is the third sector, something that I believe many of us would observe has suffered somewhat, given that when budgets get tight, the contributions that are made by many of the larger services, particularly police, to some of our charitable organisations diminishes. So that's almost a self-fulfilling prophecy of defeat in that regard. But in terms of the redefining the role, I think the role of the police officer is actually very simple. It's there to provide reassurance and assistance to the public. It's what it's been defined for. It's to guard, patrol and watch, as has been laid out in legislation almost since time immemorial. The activities of police officers haven't really changed much over the decades either. It's just that there are different approaches to how the service is done. I mean, whilst in the past someone may have had to write a letter that would have taken several days to be delivered to the local constable, they now pick up a mobile phone or send a tweet, and the expectation is that they respond instantaneously. So the service has evolved only in terms of the expectations placed upon it, not in terms of the actual job itself.
I was talking particularly about some of the contracts that the police have with private parties like football matches, and we know that a lot of the services the police are charging other entities, and sometimes these bills don't cover all the work that police officers are doing, and particularly during the weekend. And with the budget is just now, and particularly the elephant in the room, the pension, and you can maybe want to talk about it. We don't know what's going to happen in 2015 and 2016 budget. Would it be not time to address these points?
Yes, certainly, Mr. Allard, and the issue of how we deal with services to, the likes of large public events such as football matches or rock concerts or whatever is something that needs to be looked at. I think in some ways that comes back to the point that I made in my submission about what we expect the police service to do, and indeed what we expect other services to do. And I made a particular comment in respect of health, which we may be able to explore later on. But if there is an expectation that the police will police regardless, but in some circumstances where there are large gatherings of members of our communities, that that will be a chargeable service, then that's something that needs to be properly understood by everyone. Because whilst it is easy to identify Celtic and Rangers and possibly tea in the park and possibly large golf-type events, the concept in its own right could notionally extend down to the local village, Highland Games or sporting event. There are things that need to be really understood about the expectation to pay for policing. I know that the issues of how football events are policed in their own right were previously discussed by, I think, Niven Rennie of the Superintendents Association last week, so I don't need to go into that. But there will always be, I think until such time as there is a genuine open conversation about whether police services are free, regardless of what the activity is, or whether they're going to be charged in terms of certain activities, then we'll probably be thrashing this around for a long period of time to come.
Thank you. Elaine, followed by Sandra.
Thank you, Convener. Last week, Chief Superintendent Rennie and Stephen Diamond both described to us a degree of stress that their members were working under, people not taking unpaid, you know, people either not taking, getting overtime, or if they didn't get overtime, having to work longer hours, coming to work when they were unwell and that sort of thing. Is that the same experience with your members at the moment?
Not with me personally.
No, but your members.
I think anyone who's to paint a picture that everything in the garden was rosy would be misleading just now. There is a phenomenal amount of pressure placed on police officers just now. We've only got to look at the exceptional year we've had in terms of large mass participation public events, all of which in their own right have demanded considerable police resources and considerable flexibility on the part of police officers to attend them. But let me be clear, the greatest unhappiness in the police service just now is not because of Police Scotland. The greatest unhappiness in the police service just now is because of the economy and because of changes to their pensions. There is massive anger, upset and a huge sense of betrayal that terms and conditions which police officers felt they had signed up for have been taken away from under them. And police officers, like everyone else in the public sector, I acknowledge, have had to pay considerably more for their pensions over the years at a time when their wages have been being outstripped by inflation and they've either been staying stagnant or only increasing modestly. Now, add to that the fact that there is the additional stress or change brought around by the creation of the Police Service of Scotland and indeed the considerable disruption that's taken place over the past year. It's absolutely not surprising that there is a lot of stress and expressions of quite considerable low morale amongst the federated officers.
The implication, certainly I think, from Chief Superintendent Rennie last week was that some of the savings made by the creation of Police Scotland had not actually been used for frontline policing, but had actually gone into funding directorates within the Scottish Police Authority. Is that your perception?
The Scottish Police Authority has certainly grown, I think, larger than I envisaged it would. I'm perfectly clear that I consider the Scottish Police Authority conceptually to be the right thing to have been done. Where I think there was, with hindsight, and probably a lack of detail, was that whilst the old police boards and authorities could have relied on the local authorities, legal services departments, so on and so forth, to provide some support, that wasn't in existence to the same extent for the Scottish Police Authority. So the Scottish Police Authority, like the Police Service of Scotland, is an evolving beast, and I think it probably needs to cut its cloth more appropriate to the financial circumstances, because we cannot have a circumstance where the body that is responsible for governing can grow exponentially at a time when the service itself is expected not to.
Is it not also the case, if I'm trying to remember, that when there was the 8 constabularies were exempt from VAT, but in fact with that must have cost a pretty penny?
Yes, indeed.
That VAT is now levied and not recoverable.
Yeah, it's. I think it's a matter of immense frustration for us all.
Right, thank you. Sandra, followed by Roderick.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Callum, Mr. Steele. You did mention earlier about hope we could get into more depth in regard to the transfer of funds from the police services to the health service. That was one of the questions I wanted to ask, because having, you know, obviously visited prisons as part of the Justice Committee, it seemed that it was more like streamlining if we were able to get the NHS involved rather than it being separate. So perhaps could you expand on why you're concerned about this specific aspect of budget?
I'm concerned about the notion rather than the specific aspect. If I work it backwards, the police service and police officers have an enormous involvement with individuals who suffer from mental health on a day-to-day basis. It's a large proportion of police time is taken up with dealing with individuals who have mental health. Arguably, not the best approach. In fact, not arguably the best approach, undoubtedly not the best approach, because I can think of fewer things that are more corrosive to individuals that are suffering ill health and to find themselves stuck in a solid concrete room with a steel door and a small wicket to look at. But because the police service is engaged in that kind of crisis intervention and management at the first instance, we don't see a corresponding transfer of funding from health to police to deal with that. And I'm of the view that if the police are expected to police regardless, the health service should be expected to deliver health regardless. And irrespective of whether an individual is in police custody or not, then the health service should have a responsibility for looking after them. There are areas where police should pay for additional health elements, and they include clearly the exposure to forensic examinations and the requirements to gather blood. But if, as happens in a large proportion of cases, we have individuals that are suffering mental illness, a health consideration, locked up in cells, why is the police paying for the failure, a motive perhaps, but for the failure of a health system that allows that individual to be in a cell in the first place by giving money back to health? It seems to me like health is getting a double dividend there, possibly. But there are other elements, of course, which I think are unnecessarily complex about the cost of the provision of medical forensic services. You know, if we look at road traffic legislation, for example, a doctor has to take a blood sample from an accused person. Now, as far as I am aware, and I have two sisters that work as nurses, most bloods are now drawn by nurses. Now, the cost of that and having to pay for the securing of doctors to draw blood will be considerably higher than having to pay for nurses to draw blood if, of course, the legislation was to allow it. And again, we're not helped by the fact that across Scotland, as I understand it, we don't have a single point of negotiation with the health service, not least because the health service exists as an umbrella body, but we've got the individual health boards and authorities underneath it, for the provision of doctor services. So we have to undertake that process many times over, and that in itself is highly inefficient and wasteful.
Thank you. I mean, my understanding was, obviously, the professionals in the health service were the best people to look at, you know, people who are in custody, and it would be much more seamless and better for the prisoner or anyone who's held over in remand. And you mentioned about absolutely understandable that people with mental health problems shouldn't be in prison. They should, but society, sometimes it doesn't come to the fore until, unfortunately, they are arrested. So what the point I'm trying to make is, when you mentioned about police officers being deployed to other services because they may have this particular experience, surely it would be better people who have in the medical profession who have the experience medically, would that not be better that they do treat these people rather than the police service? Or is it just a purely budgetary issue that you're raising here?
It's a budgetary issue. I mean, clearly the best people to deal with health are health professionals.
The point being made is that the police shouldn't be paying for it. The health service should be putting money into the police. The other way around from what's happening, I think, if I'm following your point.
Or we avoid this merry-go-round of taking money from one to give it to the other, and we just see the responsibility is yours, go on with it.
It's all right, Convener. I know that was a point that Mr. Steele was making, but I just wanted to expand on it that, basically the reasons I understand it to be the reason that money was being taken from that particular budget to the health service, because it was more seamless and the professionals were in the health service. And I don't think you're denying that. What you're saying is that basically it is a purely budgetary issue in that respect. If I could just pick up on one other point which I found interesting, and probably goes down to the nitty-gritty as well, about looking at the whole of what people expect on how the health service, the police service should be paid for. When you mentioned about the doctors, they're the only people that can come and take blood, whereas normally it would be a nurse. That's something that perhaps we should look at in a budgetary sense as well.
Yes, and, and indeed, and I regret that I'm not so up on parliamentary procedure. In fact, I think, again, that horse may also have gone, that the possibility of an amendment, given the change to drink driving legislation, may have provided the opportunity for that. Of course, I'm not sure that would sit with the Parliament or not, but these kind of things in the round need to be looked at. The traditional approach of we've done it this way, therefore we've got to continue doing it this way, isn't going to sustain the services in Scotland. In fact, it's not going to sustain them anywhere in the UK the way cuts are going at this moment in time.
Just a type of follow-up question anyway. You would be supportive then of what we heard last week by the Superintendency Association that said that we really need to look at the whole issue of budgetary regarding the police and what people expect of the police force?
I mean, I think that's an inevitable development of lack of finance. I suspect I know the answer. The answer will be that they want the police to do what the police have always done. They want nurses to do what they've always done, teachers to do what they've always done, social workers to do what social workers have always done, and councils to do what councils have always done. Now, I think that will be the answer. No one will be prepared to have the conversation about how it's meant to be done with less money. I mean, we've seen that since 2007, there's been a 6% real terms cut to Scotland's grant. Now, services have increased exponentially since the Parliament came into being, across all ranges of the public sector. And if the tap had been turned off and it had been kept static, that would have been a challenge enough. But against a reducing budgetary background, it's really, really difficult. And I see no desire on anyone's part to start having the real conversations about how that's going to be addressed.
Thank you, Kevin. Thank you.
I've got Roderick. John, have you that your question been asked, or have you got something else?
Small one, if I may, please.
Well, not yet. Roderick, then Alison, and then John Finney.
Sorry, Kevin, was your question directly related to that?
No. He's on my list.
Okay.
It's all right. Please don't try to organise me. It's all right. Roderick.
I wouldn't dream of it, Kevin.
I know what I'm doing, I think.
Morning, Mr. Steele. If I'd just like to follow on from the questions that my colleague Elaine Murray was raising in terms of the evidence given last week by Chief Superintendent Rennie. It's my looking at kind of the report from the Scottish Police Authority in terms of overtime said that the overtime budget for police officers had been exceeded by almost $500,000. Chief Superintendents talked about kind of demands on their time. I remember last year you talked about kind of your view that overtime was being reduced because of the large numbers of police officers with the target 17,234. What's your kind of current view on kind of overtime demands on officers?
Looking at the past 12 months, the demands on officers in terms of flexibility have been considerable. That's been anything ranging from short notice shifts to shift changes to enormous changes in the overall shift patterns that they work. But the nature of police work and the nature of overtime in particular over the past 12 months has been very unpredictable. I mean, no one could have known that events at the likes of the Commonwealth Games could have ended up with such a large overtime requirement. But changes in threat assessment or security considerations inevitably impact on that. We either have police officers that are going to have their daily lives and their existence chopped from pillar to post and uncertainty how they're going to work, or we're going to have to pay them overtime. And if it's going to be the former, then we have to make sure that they're properly remunerated in the first place to make that a tolerable burden on what they're expected to do. So I think it's likely that overtime and the demands for overtime will continue to exist in the manner that they always have. But inevitably, I think that the availability of it in terms of payment or time back is going to reduce. So I rather fear that the service may get to a situation where it expects the goodwill of individuals to continue to perform and to continue to put in extra hours without getting any compensation for it, which in itself has underlying difficulties, not least in what it can mean for the individual's health and possibly conflicts with working time requirements.
Thank you. A separate question in terms of the report from HM Inspector of Constabulary in relation to local policing in Fife, where they believe that there was a kind of widespread view amongst both support staff and police officers that the previous family feel of the Fife Constabulary had been lost slightly in the new setup. Could you comment on that, and do you feel that's been an issue elsewhere in Scotland, or is it unique to Fife?
I don't believe it's unique to Fife, but I have no empirical evidence one way or another to support it. I've got anecdotes galore, but they are of limited value.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. I'm trying to move everybody on, mindful that we have to suspend at 10:58, and Mr. Emery has to leave after the two-minute silence, so forgive me if I rush you along, because this is a longer session than expected. Alison, followed by John Finney.
Thank you. I'll be brief. Last week, Mr. Penman told us that this forthcoming year, in budgetary terms, will be much more challenging than what we faced before. We know that the business case for the savings, that the savings were predicated on, was pretty sketchy. Would you support calls for a review of the timetable for the delivery of the savings that were supposed to come through reform?
The short answer to that is probably yes. The long-term issue of finance, whilst it might be made easier if it's done in slower time, I don't think it's going to go away. But certainly, the expectation that the service is going to deliver £1.1 billion by 2025-26, I mean, that's a year's worth of policing for free. I mean, that's just how stark that kind of expectation is. Whilst I am absolutely content that had the services not amalgamated the challenges facing the former constabularies, had they continued in their form, it would have been greater than that being faced by the Police Service of Scotland at this moment in time. I do think a slightly slower time approach to realise the savings in the round would be of greater benefit to the service, because there is a danger that when cash is king, and at this moment in time cash is king in everything, that much of what could be looked at with probably a greater consideration as to the right way of delivering the service could get lost. But of course, we don't know. We'll just have to see if that opportunity presents itself.
Thank you.
John. Brief, very brief, please.
Mr. Steele, there's been a suggestion. A number of us have met with operational frontline officers that rather than serving the public, they increasingly feel they're serving the plethora of new departments that have been set up in some areas. That's bound to have an impact on their workload, the individual officers' workload, potentially, and overtime budgets. The example given was of officers dealing with a domestic violence incident, which we all know is very important, but then delivering their reports to a department of five who always find something further for them to investigate into. To what extent is the overtime budget impacted by the growth of these departments and the additional work that comes back out to the frontline officers?
I'm afraid that only Police Scotland will be able to answer that one specifically, but one thing I am keen to highlight is that the Scottish Police Federation has members in these departments. We have police officers, all of whom are working flat out to deliver an incredible service to the public, be they in departments or be they in what we would traditionally consider to be answering the call and turning up at the door. There is an inevitable, in fact, it was ever thus, that when a new expectation comes along, a department is formed, that resource comes from, or the resource for the department comes from what is termed, or loosely termed, the front line. I think in simple terms it means those that are available to do the response calls. And certainly the words that I get from across Scotland is that there are fewer and fewer people available for the response side of the policing. But that's not to say that those that are engaged in the various departments aren't doing something considerably worthwhile either. This is why, you know, I say again, we need to have an honest conversation about what is expected from the police service. Because if we only look at the time it takes for someone to attend to a call and deal with the incident and get the offender to court, we're missing out large elements of it. But in the example you gave, domestic incidents in particular, they do take a long time to see through from beginning to end. And a large part of that is, I think, down to the welcome consideration that the service has delivered to this subject over the years, where I think in the past there could well be probably fair fingers of accusation being pointed that it wasn't dealt with as properly as it could have been. Now, we may have gone too far, but rather be too far than not far enough, I think.
Thank you. Can I thank you very much, Edward, for your evidence? It's very thoughtful and slightly provocative, as usual. Thank you very much. I'm going to suspend just for 1 minute, Calum, to allow the witnesses to change over, to allow us some time. Thank you. Thank you very much. Before I move on to the next panel, I'd like to inform members, witnesses and those in the public gallery that you're invited to observe the 2 minute silence at 11 a.m. and will be asked to stand for this as a mark of respect. There will be a sound that comes over to tell you when it starts, and we'll stand for that period, and then if you wish, and then it will tell when that 2 minute has concluded and we'll resume business. But I know that, Mr. Emery, thank you very much for coming at pretty short notice, and I know that you do have to go immediately after the 2 minute silence. So that puts you all on notice. Short, sharp, tricky questions for our panel. I welcome Vic Emery, Chair, and John Foley, Chief Executive of the Scottish Police Authority. I know you heard the tail end of some of the evidence there from Calum Steele. And so can I go? I've got your written submissions straight to questions. John, you're in right away at the starting gate, and Elaine.
Okay, thank you. Morning, panel. John. It's just to ask about the importance of the IT structures that the police service have to deal with. Can you give us reassurance about the state they're in? I know there's significant plans that will enhance delivery if they're indeed delivered. There's no surprises in the future for us coming from that, financial or otherwise.
I'll ask John to deal with the detail, but I can tell you that there are a number of initiatives now in train to be more innovative in the way we police Scotland, and to reduce the cost of doing so, and the ICT is a key enabler for allowing that to happen. So you will have got from your written evidence a lot of the programs that are currently ongoing. You know about an I6 program, you know about the C3 program, you know about the custody program, you know about the single ledger, you know about payroll, and you know about all of these programs, which all rely on ICT. We have set up a governance framework. Police Scotland come to the office on a regular basis. We scrutinise them as to how they're spending their money, what progress there is against each of those programmes, and to date, I can't say that there's anything untoward going on. ICT is a strange beast. Things can go wrong without you knowing it, but we have put in place a good governance structure which hopefully will prevent that from happening, because we absolutely want a no surprises situation on ICT. John.
Thank you. Yes, in relation to ICT, we have applied robust governance structures against all of the major projects. There is no significant slippage on any of the projects, and indeed the most high profile is I6. And there is a programme board which I sit on. I also chair the ICT Scrutiny Forum, which Vic has referred to. And in relation to I6, all of the key milestones have been met in accordance with the programme. There has been a gateway review which was carried out fairly recently in relation to I6, and the project was given an amber green, and it was well reported that the governance arrangements were acceptable and robust.
Okay. Thank you very much indeed. Thank you, Kavira.
Elaine, followed by Sandra, please.
Thank you. Good morning. Previous witnesses have indicated that the cost of running the SPA is higher than anticipated. Would they be correct? And by how much more does the SPA cost to run than was anticipated when it was set up?
The SPA was benchmarked. If you look back to the legacy governance arrangements. They were highly criticised by both HMIC and Audit Scotland with regard to the areas that they actually didn't look at. And most specifically, it was the governance of the financial arrangements within the police forces within those legacy areas. We have addressed those shortfalls and we have staffed the SPA to address those issues. Far be it, I want to dispel immediately the notion that the SPA is growing while police are shrinking. That couldn't be further from the truth. And the benchmark for this is actually, we've benchmarked the Metropolitan Police, the PSNI and other forces, and the cost of the governance is approximately 0.5% of the overall budget. And we are well within 0.5% of the overall budget. So we are governing the police well within the established norms for doing that. John?
Yes, in addition to that, the SPA also has statutory responsibilities which it must discharge, not least of which is producing sets of statutory accounts which cover SPA budget, which also includes Police Scotland. So we have to have staff in place to deal with that. We have dealt with these matters effectively. We have recently produced a set of accounts which will be laid before Parliament, and you know, these take people to do that. So, as Vic says, it's less than 0.5% of the budget. We're not fully up to staff yet. There's still a few positions to be recruited for, but we are not growing. We have a finite number of positions which has been agreed and certainly debated in public, and there is a ceiling on that. We will not go above that ceiling.
We're discussing the budgets are increasingly constricted, so what is SPA doing to reduce its own costs?
Well, in terms of SPA, we have looked to be as efficient as we possibly can. We operate on a zero-based basis each year, so we build the budget up from scratch. We have moved premises recently to free up some estate and made considerable savings in lease costs on a property which we occupied in central Glasgow. So we've moved over to Pacific Quay and took a floor in a building which was vacant, but which was already being paid for. So there was a saving there, and members will also recall at previous meetings that we've given evidence in relation to Bremner House in Stirling, which we give up the lease for that as well, and that freed up some additional cost savings also.
Mm-hmm. Your submission does suggest that the most of the savings made through duplication have now been made. That's going to put additional pressures on Police Scotland. Have you any sort of comment about that and any concerns you've got in the budget next year?
In relation to duplication, I would advise that there is no duplication between SPA and Police Scotland. Indeed, officers work complementary to each other.
Which existed in the previous forces. The savings from those have now been made, and that's no longer a source of saving.
There may be some savings. By and large, those savings have materialised over the past year and a half. There may be some other savings which could materialise as a result of perhaps some consolidation in relation to duplications. I'm thinking here that aspects such as payroll, for example, where we still have a large number of distinct payrolls, so we may be able to pull some of them together into one. So there are some savings, but not of the same significance as we've managed to achieve over the first 2 years.
We have always viewed the reform of policing in three stages, the first stage being bringing all the forces into one force, a second stage being consolidating that position and therefore getting rid of some of the redundancy, and the third stage, which we're just embarking on, which is the transformational stage where we do things differently than we did before.
Are there any options for savings which you've considered in the past but rejected, which might come back to the table again?
We have considered all options. The number of things that we could do to save money has not been exhausted by a long way. There is nothing that's off the table at the moment, and that we will look at whatever we can do to maintain the service at a best value to the public.
Thank you. followed by Sandra, followed by John Pentland, then Roderick.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, gentlemen. We're talking about savings, obviously, in the budget, and one of the areas which I have been concerned about for a while, and you have mentioned it in your report, is about the VAT recovery, £24 million, which obviously at the moment has been taken out of the police reform funding. That could certainly go some way towards, you know, savings and better services also. Could you expand particularly on the situation at the moment with the VAT, obviously £24 million a year, which have we at any stage been able to recover that money, or have we came to anything at all?
The VAT situation was declared right from the beginning, when actually the SPA and Police Scotland were set up as a non-departmental government body. I have to say that's not the same as England and Wales. In England and Wales, they do not pay VAT. We unfortunately do pay VAT. Scottish Government has agreed to look at the rationale behind that, to give us parity to some extent with what's happening south of the border. But the fact remains that at the moment we do have to pay VAT. And you're quite right, the VAT varies a little, but it's sort of around between 22 and 24 million, dependent upon what we buy. Most of the expenditure of police is on salaries and on people costs, and so this VAT attaches itself to services and materials that are bought in. For the first 3 years, that is paid from the reform budget, but that becomes a burden, or another challenge, shall we say, from 2015 onwards.
Just to pick up on the point, you did ask if we'd been able to recover any of it, and unfortunately we haven't been able to recover any of it. Moving forward, colleagues in Scottish Government are speaking with colleagues in London to see if we can address that situation. However, in our forward planning, we have to assume that we will not recover any VAT. That's how we plan, and therefore, if we are successful in obtaining a recovery situation, that will be to the good in relation to the overall police budgets.
What, £24 million, £24 million would buy in terms of police resources? Mm. I mean, what does that, on a practical level for the public, mean you're not getting if you have to, don't get that support after 2015?
The VAT is a cost to policing.
If you've got to, if you're not getting that support, as you are just now from the fund, and at the end of 2015 you're not going to have that, you're going to have to cut that from what you can spend, what would that buy in terms of police resources for the police on the front, Police Scotland?
That's
I'm not an accountant, so I don't know what £24 million does. No.
Well, if you look at the SPA, we've had that discussion about the cost of the SPA. The SPA costs less than £4 million.
Right, yes. What was your...
I was being flippant, convener.
Could I just... follow that, but I think it's an important point which has been missed over the past couple of years, and certainly I've raised it on numerous occasions. 90%, my understanding is 90% of the budget is staff costs. Now, you're losing this £24 million throughout the years. We've got IT systems and that type of thing. And I'm not necessarily making a political point here, but what I think we do have to realise that Wales is a devolved governance. They don't pay VAT. And then obviously in Westminster, they don't pay VAT either. And you've got to ask the question, and I hope that the government will be able to come to some arrangement, why is the Scottish Government in Scotland being penalised by not getting the same as Wales and the rest of the UK?
Well, I think you make a valid point. We are addressing that with the Scottish Government, but the fact is, from the SPA's point of view, it is a challenge, it is a cost element that we have to take account of when we are setting the budgets moving forward. So until it is removed, we do have to allow for the fact that we need to address it moving forward.
Thank you very much. Thank you.
Okay, John Pentland, followed by Roderick, followed by Christian.
Thank you, Convener. Mr Emery, I'm not too sure if I picked up your answer to Elaine Murray with regards to what have you rejected in relation to some savings that have come forward as a suggestion. Could you perhaps give us some examples of what has been rejected?
Either I didn't answer the question properly or I wasn't very conclusive in what I said. We have rejected no suggestions at the moment as to how we might make savings. We are prioritising the initiatives that are coming forward so that we can actually concentrate on the ones that give us the best return for the investment that we need to make.
So,
If I could just come in there as well, there are timing issues associated with some of the savings and savings plans that come forward. We touched at the beginning on ICT projects such as I6 and C3. So these are priority projects which require a large degree of dedicated resource, and the savings don't manifest themselves immediately. So whilst we consider those savings plans and implement them, there will be other savings plans which will come forward which we will have to give equal consideration to, but we may not be able to implement them immediately because we may have to wait until some of the projects that are already underway come to fruition.
Yeah. If I'm right then, that you have not rejected any savings that has come forward from the Chief Constable. And the reason I ask that is quite clear. Do you base your assumption on meeting the savings or the impact that may have in the community? So how do you base your decision?
When a business proposition is put before us, there is what we call a business case that's put forward. We have an equality assessment that's attached to every business case, and we have a community assessment attached to those business cases as well. So we are not saying, I want to make it clear, we are not saying that we want to make savings at the expense of the service. We want to maintain the service. We are interested in the outcomes that the service delivers to local communities, and we don't do that. We don't dilute that at the expense of cost.
So, have you ever challenged the business case that was put before you?
If you were to, you need a lot of time, I agree, but if you were to look at some of the board meetings, you will see we challenge quite robustly all of the business cases that are placed before us.
Having challenged them, have you ever changed the decision then?
I'm sorry, I didn't...
Well, you know, obviously you've challenged the business case, but have you ever changed the recommendation that was associated with that business case?
We have encouraged the police to change direction or to take other things into account in the challenging that we do.
Okay. Moving on to, obviously, the pre-Scotland, when it was unified, has created challenges. And perhaps some of the my questions are associated, Convener, to the scheme of administration and just how rigorous, the SPAR and making the challenges that you spoke about. And when I read through your scheme of administration, I'm just wondering just how well, you are equipped to be challenging, because I see that you're allowed to buy in the regions between £200,000 and £500,000, right? So that to me says that they're either, if you're moving it from one budget to another, they're either one budget's got £200,000 more than it should have had. So are we aware of what the actual expenditure is in that? And the other one is with regards to in your finance report, the six-month period to 30 September, there is a saving of £1.5 million on police officer costs. Now, either that assumption has been well off the mark, and it's just how confident can we be in the SPA that when challenging the budget, that you're aware, can we have a more robust performance from you? Probably that's what I'm trying to say.
Well, again, I'll let John deal with the detail of the question, because you went into some figures, which, from a governance point of view, that's what I allow the Chief Executive to do. But we have put the scheme of delegation and the scheme of administration in place to give proper and robust challenge. And as far as I am aware, that has not been varied at all. And there are committees that have been set up, most notably in the finance area, the Finance and Investment Committee, who challenge everything that comes forward and need to see where all the money is being spent, why it is being spent in the way it is, and is it good value for money. John, do you want to deal with the detail?
Yes, if you don't mind. Thank you. As Vic says, we do have robust governance processes and procedures. The scheme of administration is only one of those, but one of the most important, because it leads into other items like the scheme of delegation within SPE and Police Scotland, and we also have framework agreements, etc., with Scottish Government. In terms of the point on veerment, there has been absolutely no veerment taking place from one budget to another at all. The provision is there to create that flexibility. However, it hasn't actually been applied, and it wouldn't actually be applied unless I was consulted as accountable officer. So in relation to Veermont, that's where we take that. In relation to budgets overall, as Vic pointed out, we do have a Finance and Investment Committee. That committee meets once a month, and all of the budgets are and the financial performances are robustly challenged, both in relation to revenue expenditure and capital expenditure, and explanations given as to variances at that particular point in time. Specifically in relation to finance, there is also a weekly finance meeting which takes place between senior officers in SPA and Police Scotland, and I chair that meeting. So we actually do look at budgets and challenge budgets on a weekly basis, and then monthly through the committee, and then through the board itself, where finance reports are presented to the board, and board members, all board members have an opportunity to question the Director of Finance at Police Scotland and the Chief Constable in relation to all budgetary matters.
Okay. Could you perhaps tell me, Mr. Foley, how many devolved budgets there are?
In relation to devolved budgets, there is a degree of devolution in relation to devolved budgets at commander level, but it's restricted, as you would understand, because most of the policing budgets, over 90%, relate to people costs. So those costs are already there. However, for local matters such as overtime and small purchases of goods and services on a local basis, community-type purchases, then that would be devolved at that level. So there's 14 commands. So that's the degree of which that devolution would take place.
Mm-hmm. To date, we are probably, you've got, I believe, a £58 million capital budget for this year. And I think to date there's only been £4.5 million spent of that. Considering we're only 6 months away, can you give us assurance that money will be spent?
Yes, indeed. As recently as last week, I was sitting with the Director of Finance from Police Scotland, and we were going through the capital budget forecast in great detail, and we will spend the capital budget this year as we had intended. There are timing issues as at the end of September, only because there are some of the projects we're working on, for example I6 and some others, where there's an element of expenditure which comes into the second half of the year, and that was planned, so we will spend that. In addition to savings, we're confident that we'll achieve the savings for this year as well, which would put us in a position of, in 2012, having saved £11 million, £64 to £65 in 2013-14, which has been audited, and that's finalised. And hopefully, we're forecasting this year £68. So everything's on course for delivery for the end of the financial year.
Yeah. The board. We had a board meeting last week, and Police Scotland were questioned quite extensively on the budget, and Police Scotland reassured the SPA that the capital would be spent this year on bona fide projects.
And that's on the projects that was identified at the start of the financial year.
Yes.
Because I do have a concern that when you're unable to carry forward your capital monies, you know, sometimes when it gets near the end of the year, you just, you know, any good officer's always able to pull up a project off the shelf and get spent in that, you know, So the money that has been spent on what was identified at the beginning of the year.
Yes, we have a capital spend plan which is presented when the budget is presented, and we monitor that carefully.
Yes.
Yeah. And there won't be any underspend.
There won't be any underspend, okay. No.
That was what they call forensic, which someone was asking what forensic was. So thank you, John. Roderick, followed by Christian, followed by Alison.
Good morning. About this time last year, we heard evidence from Chief Constable House that more than 300 police officers around Scotland were paid at that stage from funded solely by local authorities. As you, as an authority, are you able to tell us what the position is today in relation to funding from local authorities towards police officers, or is that something I should address to the Chief Constable?
The detail of that you should obviously addressed to the Chief Constable. I can tell you that from our perspective, there is, and John may have the precise numbers, but in round terms, Glasgow funds about £3 million per year, and Edinburgh about £2 million per year to the budget for local policing or additional policing in those areas. They are the only two city environments that contribute outside of the budget that's sent down from the Scottish Government. John, do you have any details?
Vic, the details that you gave are broadly correct, so I have no further comment.
Okay, thank you. And just moving back to the question of the VAT recoverability, not exactly back of the fag packet calculation, is if we have a resource budget in excess of £1 billion, if we're talking about recovering VAT of about £24 million, we're talking about probably about a 2.4% increase in the budget. And if you apply that to the number of police officers, we're talking about 430 or so police officers. Would you disagree with that?
I don't understand the question.
Are you meaning that the £24 million
in VAT
would pay for X number of police officers? Yeah. Well, yes, I mean, obviously, the £24 million, if you were to take it into that level, you could have that as an offering of how many more police officers you have. You could have other resources. You could have additional air support, for example.
And yes, trying to get an answer to what does it mean, that money?
Yes, indeed, convener. Yeah. That's,
I thank you that's for counting. He's that's obviously been working on that with his abacus for some time.
I said it was just a rough calculation. Can I move on to a slightly separate area? Obviously, we've heard evidence over the last couple of panels about the HM Inspector of Constabulary report on local policing within Fife, and about issues whether morale is being affected by the pace and nature of the change, and that the family feel in Fife had gone. I appreciate, as an authority, that's perhaps difficult to monitor, but have you any comments on that general comment?
Again, the detail can be addressed by John, but in general terms, as you know, we're 18 months into a major programme which will lead to reforming the police as we move forward. By necessity, well, not by necessity, it is a known fact that any big programme like that, there is an element of discomfort amongst the people that are involved. And that can lead to all sorts of different ramifications. Low morale might be one of them. I'm not saying it is, but it might be one of them. But it's the uncertainty that brings that sort of feeling with it. I am getting information that morale is not as high as we would like it to be. My balance to that is the fact that we are in a reform program, and therefore there's some of that that's almost inevitable. But we are, as a part of our employment engagement program, going to conduct a survey so that we can actually, rather than speculate on this, we can actually get some hard facts. So Everyone that works in Police Scotland and in the SPA will be asked to participate in an employee survey so that we can actually assess for ourselves rather than speculate what their situation is.
Thank you, Convener.
Could I just give just a slight detail there? This is a matter which is widely recognised, as something that we need to monitor closely, and we do that through our governance structures, primarily the HR and Remuneration Committee. As Vic has said, there is a survey planned. That survey will take place prior to the end of this financial year, and thereafter a regular survey will take place every 2 years, which is widely recognised as an appropriate time frame to attend to such matters.
Thank you very much. I'm going to come to, if you forgive me, I'll go let Christian and Alison in first, and I've got time, John, bearing in mind the time to let you in. So Christian, then Alison, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. Regarding incertitudes and morale for the police officers, we were told in different panels that there is a terms and conditions, a change in terms and conditions for the police officers, and particularly the pension, which may be the elephant in the room, being, I see, we are planning a 10 million, around about 10 million increase for the 2015-2016 budget. How much is that affecting the morale? How much that incertitude about how much you will have to provide for pension for the police is a problem for you? And when do you think you'll have clarification from Westminster how much you will have in your budget for pension in 2015-2016?
In relation to pensions, as Calum Steele gave some evidence earlier, it is a cause for concern amongst police officers, as it is across the public sector. So we can't underestimate the impact of that. In relation to the SPA budgets, we don't actually hold the budget for police officer pension costs. That's met centrally by Scottish Government, so it doesn't impact. But we are acutely aware of the impact on individuals and on staff morale as a result of the pension increases that people are having to pay at a time when inflation is outstripping wage increases.
Yeah, but it's another problem on morale. We talked about it, some of my colleagues talked about it, talking about the extra hours that some of them have to do, particularly superintendents. And we talked about with other panels about the problem of the weekend trend. More and more officers have to work over the weekends. Do you think, is it time to review what the Police Scotland services, Police Scotland should provide? Or do you think it's too early to do that after the changing into single force? Or do you think we should have a review now and to see what exactly Police Scotland service should provide, and particularly over time over the weekends?
We understand pretty much the service that Police Scotland deliver to communities. We have active engagement with all of the local authorities and the security committees within those councils. There is a very positive relationship that's been built up over the last period, and we're not getting any negativity from those committees with regard to the services that the police are delivering to those communities. With regard to the levels of overtime, we are interested in the cost of delivering policing, and therefore the overtime element is a part of that. But the Chief Constable is responsible for the direction and control of the people reporting to him, and therefore he determines the overtime and the deployment of people under his command.
But do you think that it's not going to be a challenge on the budget, particularly we heard about salary slices for the budget, and a danger that a smaller budget will affect that level of policing? And don't you think it would be time to try to, after the reform we had the last 2 years, it would be time to maybe think another reform, which would be reforming what police duties should be?
I think that the reform programme will take, we're only 1.5 years into a very substantial reform programme, and there are many projects that are yet to deliver the savings, both cashable and non-cashable savings as we move forward. I think that we need to get those programmes well underway. We have started this week, actually. Yesterday we had a meeting with academics and the Police Scotland and the Scottish Government to look at where we all think policing should be in 5 years, in 10 years and in 15 years' time, to see what demographic pressures there are on the society, how society will evolve, the level of diversification and immigration that comes into Scotland, so that we can start looking at where do we want policing to be in the future and what will the cost of policing be in the future, what skill sets do we need for policing to have going forward, and what will be the balance between uniformed people and non-uniformed people. All of that work has started.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Alison followed. We'll see if we've got time. John Pentland and Sandra. But Alison first.
Thank you. Before turning to my question, I just want to comment on what you said about staff morale, and you seem to almost imply that it was inevitable because of the change. And I kind of caution against that. I mean, it's maybe a bit telling that it's taken you 2 years to survey your staff about that. And that in itself, I think, is a concern. But turning to the main question that I have, we heard last week from Mr. Penman that the challenges ahead in balancing the budget this year will be harder than they've been up until now. And that if we don't get that right, there's an impact on operational effectiveness and police performance, perhaps falling service. We heard Chief Superintendent Rennie say that his staff were facing an intolerable burden. So I wonder how you react to those two statements.
Yes, certainly, when Mr. Penman made the comments about the budget, he is absolutely correct. The challenge does become greater as we move through a period of generating significant efficiencies, which we have done over the past 2 years, then invariably, as you move forward into that process, it does become harder to save. We have been set the challenge of saving £1.1 billion by 2026. We are confident, both the SPA and Police Scotland are confident, that we can meet that challenge. In relation to Mr. Rennie's comments, that would be Mr. Rennie's view. We do have a meeting with the association tomorrow afternoon. We have regular meetings to discuss these matters, and we would look to have more detail that we can look to and hopefully address.
That you're confident that you can meet it when 1.5 years into the savings, we've got staff associations telling us that they're facing an intolerable burden.
We are the governance body for the police. A part of that is to have a finance scrutiny function within the SPA. That function works very well and works very well with Police Scotland. If you do the figures, because the savings are actually recurring savings, and if you look at the savings that have been achieved to date and those that will be achieved this year, we are well on track for delivering the requirement of £1.1 billion by 2026.
So you wouldn't support a call for a slowing down of the timetable for reform? You yourself said earlier, Mr. Emery, that you were moving into the transformational stage. That needs thought and careful decision-making. Is there a risk that short-term decisions that are driven by purely financial budget constraints will not lead to the sustainable force that we need to see in 2026?
As I've said previously to one of the previous questioners, we're not making short-term decisions. We have a very highly skilled group of people from Police Scotland, the Scottish Government, the SPA and academia looking at where we want to take policing in the next 5, 10, 15 years. The decisions that we make on the business plans that are brought before us are not a quick fix. We do not look for a quick fix. We want to look at anything that can save us money without diluting service, as we move forward. And we do not want to put anything in place that might prejudice the long-term savings. That is absolutely certain.
Clearly trying to establish whether or not the budget is sufficient to meet the needs of the Police Service of Scotland for the forthcoming year. Will you give us an assurance that if at any point you think the budget is not sufficient to deliver a safe service, that you will alert the Parliament to that?
Yes. My job as the governance body is to ensure that we have got all the savings out of the system that are available to be taken and offered back to the people of Scotland. We do not take short-term decisions in doing that. The Police Scotland need to satisfy me that actually the actions that they're taking will deliver the savings whilst they're taking those actions. And thus far, they have done that. And therefore, as you know, the 63-odd million was delivered in the first year. There is a requirement to deliver a further £68 million of savings this year. We are on track. Police Scotland have reassured me that that can be delivered too, and that is significant savings that we can deliver. Now, as you move into the third year, obviously there's a law of diminishing returns, and it gets more and more difficult. That is why you move from a consolidating position to a more reforming position, because you need to do things differently. Once you've got rid of duplication, once you've got rid of all the, I hate the term, but the low-hanging fruit, as it were, then you need into, well, how do we do things differently and more appropriately that will be more cost-effective for the public purse?
In coming to those decisions, you must take the community along with you, as I'm sure you've learned to your cost, if you don't. And therefore, that takes time to do that. So I press you on whether you think the timetable for savings is achievable.
I think the timetable for achieving the savings is a challenge. I do not think that we've exhausted all of the avenues to secure more savings.
Thank you very much. I've got 6 minutes, so I've got two. You've both got questions, but why don't you just both give me your questions and we'll see if you can do it within that time. Short questions. First, John, your short question.
I think it was good to hear Mr. Emery's comment there that to get rid of the low-hanging fruit. You know, he agrees that, you know, the closing of police counters and the closing of police stations is considered by yourself as low-hanging fruit when people in my community thought differently. However, my question is on morale, and again, I believe that, you know, the morale is at the lowest within the police support staff, you know, and it would appear to me that the burden of the efficiencies has fallen the name. What kind of assurance can you give me, you know, very quickly that we're soon near the balanced workforce? And, you know, can you tell me what further percentage of civilian police support staff is going to be reduced to meet that target?
Sandra.
Thank you very much, Chair. Looking at reforming the police service and the budget, I'll just pick up on the point of regarding policing for likes of pop concerts, sporting events, political events, etc. as well. Can we charge for that via the police? And I put in mind, obviously, Lib Dems, you know, recent one, which they have not paid yet to Police Scotland.
Now, you're both... stop, all of you, stop.
No, it's a
we're looking,
point,
yes,
Chair.
But I want the question. I don't expect you to comment on that. We're throwing things in at the very end, at the tail end. Questions about support staff and the question about charging for events, whatever they are, including, let's say, Edinburgh's Hogmanay and so on. Go for it. We've got 4 minutes, and if you can't finish that, I understand we'll have a written response from you as well. I'm so sorry to make it so curtailed as that.
Well, first of all, I would be the first to acknowledge that Police Scotland and the SPA did not communicate some of their actions effectively in the past. So I don't demur from that at all. However, having said that, we have not done anything that would prejudice the local community. So closing police offices, closing redundant houses has no material effect on the outcomes of policing in the areas where those activities happened. What was the other question?
Generally about the balance, the workforce between...
I've already, in answer to a question that Alison had and I think Roderick, I did say that we are engaged on a piece of work that actually looks at where we need to take policing. It will be far too premature to say there is a balance between the uniform people and the non-uniform people. We need to look at what skill sets we need and who is the best to deliver those skill sets to take policing forward in a best value basis. I think it's too black and white to say we need a percentage of this and a percentage of that. With regard to pop concerts and other commercial events, there is a charging policy which the Police Scotland drew up and presented to the Scottish Police Authority. We debated it and we approved a policy with amendments moving forward. So with regard to commercial events, there is a policy for charging for those events.
Political marches or events, is there a charging regime for that as well? You said commercial there, yes.
But if it's for something out of the ordinary, then there would be, yes.
Right, I think that's fine. We've pretty well satisfied the questioning and settled the temperature again, and we've got 2 minutes in hand. So that concludes this evidence session. We'll just wait for the signal at 10:58. Thank you very much, and thank you for your evidence. business. Item 3, we consider one negative instrument, the Act of Sederunt Commissary Business Amendment 2014, SSI 2014-265. This instrument provides for commissary business the winding up of deceased persons' estates, which has been started in Dingwall Court, to be continued at Inverness Sheriff Court after the Dingwall Court closes on 31st January 2015. The DPLR Committee did not draw the attention of the Parliament to this instrument. Do members have any comments on that statutory instrument? Thank you very much. Are members content to make no recommendation in relation to this instrument?
Yes.
Thank you. We now move into private session.